They like us.
They do, they do. That means we like them.
Yeah, no, that is the transaction, I feel.
Right?
I'm just going to check and make sure. Did you press record on that thing? Okay, great. We're all ready to go. Thank you,
Your
Dan.
Applause is going to be on.
Oh, yeah. I'm just putting everything on the record. I want to make sure that there's a rock solid record for this, because this is this is my peak. I don't hello, Kate.
Hello, Hamm.
We were just talking. We were just talking backstage about koans, and you asked. Well, you provided me with several koans, but my favorite one was, "Does a dog have Buddha nature?" No, I would just by way of just opening up the conversation. That's a horrible idea. I'm not gonna. I'm sorry. That was a stupid. That was a horrible segue. We actually have. But think about that. If you would, carry that with you through all of your years on this earth. And I was actually gonna ask Kate to read a passage from one of her luminary works. Do you want to talk about the work? Should I introduce the work?
As you wish.
It's 101 Alternatives to Suicide for Teens, Freaks, and Other Outlaws, which is... Is that your most recent book, or was Queer and Pleasant Danger the most recent?
Queer and Pleasant Danger was the most recent. This one goes by Hello Cruel World, and it was 2006, so it's 10 years old.
That's amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
So you, in your works, have kind of alternated between, like, theoretical and, like, practical. Like, you've written two practical manuals. Which I think is a great format.
I hesitate
format.
To think that, but no. What good is theory if you can't fucking use it?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to invite you now to read one of your practical theory lessons from your book. That is, and that can just kick off our little conversation, hamversation.
Okay. And you should all know that this lady picked this to read.
Yeah.
This is out of 101 Alternatives to Suicide.
It's my favorite one.
Because that's really all you can offer. You can't say, don't do it. You can always say, do this instead. It might be more fun. But this is... Number 69. Go on a serial suicide spree. Ooh, it got all quiet. Serial suicide. Think about it. There's a koan in and of itself. Serial suicide over and over and over. Implying you stay the fuck alive. Okay. Laugh at your own funeral. Dance on your own grave. And then skip off to a whole new life. Don't kill yourself. Kill off the part of you that badly needs to die. Of course, you are simply you, but you are also many versions of you that you create to deal with the world. You're the you that you are with your friends. You are the you that you are with a bully. You are the you that you are with your parents or folks that raised you, your boss, and your lover or lovers. Some of the yous that you've created are like Frankenstein's monster. You tried, but you fucked up. Other yous might be really creepy. Come on, we've all got those. They embody selfish, mean, or self-destructive parts of you, rather than the loving parts of who you are. Maybe you're feeling ashamed or guilty about that particular you. Well, kill it off. It's as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, make a list of the qualities that describe who that unwanted part of you is, what that part of you does, and the values that part of you hangs on to. Give that part of you a name. 2, figure out the sweetest way that it could die. Right? That's a fun thing. You know, come on, we've all got, oh, if I could go, sweet, this is how I want to go. When you're old, you start thinking about that shit. And three, kill it the way it's always wanted to die. Bam!
Number 69 out of 101, 100 other tips. It's my favorite tip. Because what I like about it is that it does kind of harness the power of violence. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like that a mind in a state of mind to benefit from your book, from this book, one of your many books. I'm doing a great job, right?
All right,
they have violence on the mind. There's an energy of violence on the mind that has to be redirected in a way literally just to anything else. These are your rules in the book, right? Is do anything, but don't be mean.
That's the only rule in the book.
Do whatever you want to stay alive, but don't be mean.
Don't be mean.
In other words, like, you can direct that violent impulse towards a part of yourself that does deserve to die.
Yeah.
You can kill it. You can indulge in all of the fantastic parts of, like, suicidal ideation. Do you know what I mean? Just, like, planning the funeral, like, planning the means, like, all of these kind of things. You are actually using the entire machine of the suicidal brain to stay alive, which is a life hack.
And that's why I love her.
It's a useful hack to stay alive. But but
that's not my favorite alternative to suicide.
What is your favorite alternative?
My favorite, I'm glad you asked.
Yeah.
My favorite alternative to suicide is moisturize. I swear, you cannot feel suicidal if you're moist.
That's so true.
I know.
That's so true.
See?
What a... You dirty whore.
Takes one to know one, darling.
I'm feeling very moist. Well, great. I'm having a hard time segueing out of that, actually. But I feel like we will just end up talking about moisturizing. We could probably, between the two of us, fill an hour.
No doubt.
But I want to talk to you about other stuff. Gender. Just kidding. I would not waste this opportunity.
All right, tell me, please.
Yeah.
In two or three sentences.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Your life journey of coming to terms with gender and how you feel comfortable with gender as yourself, you as a gendered being, right, these days.
These days?
Yeah. I won't say identify.
Yeah.
That's uncomfortable making. But how do you feel comfortable?
I feel that this is a trick question.
They all are.
Well, do you know? Okay, so I'm sure that you have been called upon to, like, account for just your identity in various interview situations.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I don't know if you've ever found yourself, like, scrambling to find, like, times in your life that would make it make sense. Where you're like, well, when I was a child, you know, I wore lipstick, and that in the montage of my life would definitely, if underscored right, would totally justify this decision later to just do this stuff. But my I found that every time I am grasping at that to try and justify it, like, to somebody else, that I just get really pissed off at myself and at them. And so my talking point answer right now is that I just decided to.
Decided to what?
I just decided to go on hormones and fucking make everybody call me something else. Like, you know, I could try and make it make sense, but this is actually, I noticed this, behold the pivot, okay? I noticed this reading.
I've been holding the pivot for the last four sentences, yes.
No, wait, I'll wait to pivot. So I guess, no, I won't wait to pivot, I'm going to pivot.
Okay.
Because Queer and Pleasant Danger,
yeah.
Your memoir,
yeah.
Which has a beautiful subtitle, which I can't remember.
I can.
Would you like to say the subtitle?
It's my favorite subtitle of anything I've ever written. And I've got some good subtitles. But this is the... I don't remember it. No. The true story of a nice Jewish boy, yes, who joins the Church of Scientology and leaves 12 years later to become... to become the lovely lady she is today.
Absolutely word perfect.
Is it? Is it?
Yeah, baby.
Whoa.
It's a beautiful subtitle.
Thank you.
It's a wonderful book.
It's a cheesy subtitle. It's a cheesy fucking book.
I feel... this is going to sound very vile, but you really do queer cheese.
I do.
Like, you are the perfect embodiment of the queering of cheesiness, I think. Like, you make cheesiness like punk, I think, kind of, which is that weird to say? I mean, yes.
I'm reaching for metaphors like camembert and blue, but none comes directly to mind, damn it. Do you have a good cheese, name of a cheese that would fit that? Queer
house
cheese.
House lights up. What's just a kidding. Queer cheese? Don't
Cambozola is a good queer cheese because it's part camembert and part gorgonzola. I am
Fuck
Cambozola.
Okay, great. No, well, yes, that, yes, that I am, you literally, that, this is how queering of cheese that you just did, that now I'm literally, just, I'm thinking about literal cheeses. This is the queering, the queerest thing I've ever experienced in my life. Wait, I was going somewhere with that. He's a great quality interviewer. I was talking about Queer and Pleasant Danger.
Yes.
Which is a memoir of sorts. Would you call it your memoir? Or would you say that there are elements of memoir in all of the stuff that you...
There's elements of memoir in everything I've written.
Right.
I think anybody who writes, when you're writing, don't you... You write from your heart. You write from your mind. You are your heart. You are your fucking mind. Or you're out of it. And that's what comes across in the page. That's what makes it personal. Otherwise, you're writing a technical manual, which is okay because people need technical manuals to operate machinery. But anything else is autobiographical.
I feel like you resist the impulse to create a definitive statement of self in that book and in general, which is why I find it interesting as a trans narrative, because... I mean this as a pure compliment. The book doesn't really make sense of your transness or your participation in Scientology.
Thank you. I'm all a quiver.
Well, no, it makes it it just makes it exciting. It's a very exciting book to read. I mean, you are swabbing the deck and stuff. This, you know, this bitch used to be on a boat with tar, like on Elrond's boat. We don't have to talk about it if you don't want.
Bare-chested, out under the hot Moroccan sun. And I ended up being first mate.
Yeah.
On L. Ron Hubbard's 364-foot private yacht. And I'm a Jewish closet case at that point in my life. And what am I doing first mate? I had to learn how to tie knots, you know, and I never really learned. The boat was so old, we had a lifeboat drill, and we lowered the lifeboats. You know, when I first came on to first mate, okay, we're going to do a lifeboat drill. We lowered the lifeboat. Here's the ocean. Lifeboat, lifeboat, lifeboat. Okay, lifeboat drill done.
Yeah.
And really, it was like none of us knew how to sail a ship. Really, my model for that book was one of my favorite novels ever is Voltaire's Candide, which traces the utterly pointless life of a self-absorbed young man as he stumbles into reckless adventure and horrible, horrible situations where he nearly dies. And I've been working for like good 15 years on my version of Candide, which I call hard candy.
I love
and,
that.
And it's about young Canfield Bromowitz, who becomes candy. At the end of every chapter, she dies a brutal sexual death. Gone, 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 dead. And like Kenny in South Park,
Yeah. Hello,
you know, back, you know, again. So.
Well, do you think there is? So I think that Candide and maybe your actual life and maybe, I think there might be something picaresque about a trans life in that you just, like the picaresque, as a form is like, I think Huck Finn is kind of a picaresque. Adventures of Augie March, the picaresque. It's like, it is, it's an adventure format that's kind of episodic where there will be like the traveling person will have an episode here and then have an episode there. And the arc of it will be like coming to terms with oneself, but it's not like a nail biting thriller. It's always like, this is the episode of the picaresque where I'm swabbing on a boat. And this is the one where you were like a traveling salesperson, right? For a while?
For Scientology? Me and drag queens fucking, yes. It's my dirty book. Lots of blowjobs.
There was an episode where you were, for a year, that you were like a live-in, you were girl. You were just girl.
Yeah.
You were
slave.
You were a live-in slave girl, and they cut you up good.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you about the book, the folks at home. It's a very excellent chapter where Kate gets cut up good.
I have
a pair
scars.
Of Seattle lesbians.
You can see the scars. And, later come up, I'll show you.
But it actually is like perfectly in place of the format of this book, where it's like, oh. Look what this bitch is doing now. She's in Seattle getting chopped up. I mean, not chopped up. Oh, no, but here, this is what I was going to say about your life. Is that there are so many, is that in the picaresque of the trans life, there are so many things where you look back on it, you're like, Jesus Christ, I can't believe that didn't end in death.
I think it's beautiful that we use the word trans these days as the inclusive term for all people who are fucking around with gender.
Yeah.
We used to call it transgender, but then that became language as language does. That got slowly to be known. Transgender is now known to be men and women who've transitioned out of another gender. That's transgender. And you don't want to step on people's toes. People who claim that identity, okay. That used to be the inclusive term. The inclusive term now is trans. What I like about that, it doesn't say trans what. Really. And if we've learned anything over the last 25 or 30 years, we've learned how to step out of a binary by questioning it, by introducing a viable third, and the binary shatters. We know how to do that. We kind of now take that for granted. But by calling ourselves trans, or by acknowledging that there is a category of people who are called trans, that's a very nuanced way of looking at life, whether you are one or you acknowledge that there are people who are trans. Because trans then spills over into pretty much everything else you fucking do. Go.
Oh, no, well, it seems like it's the reason that it's effective is it might be, is because it's more of a refusal to define something. It's like they're, it's like, oh, if you're not that, then what? It's like, if you're not going to be that, then what? And yeah, you're like, yeah. Shut your mouth. I'm not going to say, but here's my word that I will say instead. And what it means is, I'm not going to fucking tell you. I don't have to account to you of what the fuck this thing is. Am I being too hostile?
Really close, really close. Bitchy, but not hostile.
Okay, great.
When I first wrote Gender Outlaw, it was like early 90s, the whole big deal that I fucking realized about myself is that I'm not a man, that much I knew, and it was turning out that I'm not a woman. And I called myself not man, not woman. And trying to articulate that in that first book, we didn't have words like binary. I've only recently updated and revised Gender Outlaw, and so I'm very aware of what I wrote in those days. I used to call it the bipolar gender system. but this, I was actually thinking of two poles. This is before bipolar was actually a diagnosis.
Right, they used to call it manic depression. Everything
exactly.
Has been a reduced syllable count.
Yep, yep.
Ooh, as time goes on.
Ooh, yes. That's like what Australians do with pretty much every word.
Oh, they just make it.
No. Sunglasses become sunnies.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Barbecues are Barbies.
That's vile.
Australians are Aussies.
Oh, yeah.
And transgender, transsexual, transvestite
brace
are
yourself.
Trannies.
Okay. Oh,
that's where that word was coined, children.
In Australia? That makes me like, well, you know.
It was...
Of all of the drama of around that word, the idea that it has Australian origin...
Think of it, darling, down under.
Yeah.
No, this was a word that was coined in and around the drag bars in Sydney because everybody who was any kind of trans anything gravitated to the drag bars. F to M and M to F of any all sorts. Butch women gathered there to be security guards or bartenders or announcers or MCs or producers. And the M to Fs were either the drag queens or they were transvestites or street fairies or all kinds. And everybody thought that they themselves were a better identity than any of the other trans folk there. And there was a lot of fighting going on. Remember Priscilla, Queen of the Desert?
Yeah.
Right, remember the fights between the drag queens and the transsexual? which is another word that under the bus, literally in that movie. So they realized that, you know what, it's we gotta stop this infighting. This isn't working. We're all family. Let's come up with a family word. And that's how tranny emerged. It emerged as a word to calm down the infighting and acknowledge that we are fucking family. As language changes, you know, that word came to the United States through my drag mom, Doris Fish, in San Francisco.
You're kidding.
I know. And she taught that to me, and we were all trainees. And it was a loving, loving term. F to M, M to F, didn't matter. Butch women, passing women, they were called. He, she's, chicks with dicks, whatever. Whatever you were proud of being, you fell under the inclusive family word of tranny. And all I can guess is that, and there was tranny porn, and there were tranny hookers. And all I can guess is someone availed themselves of a tranny hooker, the services of a tranny hooker, or read some really cool tranny porn, which is to this day my favorite. And I write good tranny porn.
I bet you do.
I do. Huckleberry Finn was my good tranny porn story.
That's in the notes. We're talking about that in a sec.
Okay. But then they were so embarrassed and ashamed of themselves that it got turned into a weapon and is, in fact, a terrible weapon these days. I was talking about nuance earlier. We're living in an age where we have to really listen to context. I learned this with Jenny Boylan on the bus with Caitlyn Jenner.
Another bus, another famous bus.
Yo! We talked about Priscilla a lot on that bus. We did. But Jenny...
Kate's like, what?
Jenny and I... Jenny Boylan had a terrible experience of beyond harassment into a serious beating. At which she was called tranny over and over and over again for the better part of an hour. And this is the real use of the word trigger, in which you've had a traumatic experience and hearing a word or something associated with that throws you back into that experience. Trigger as a word now has changed, and it literally means anything that makes me feel uncomfortable or unsafe. No, it's a valid thing. This makes me very uncomfortable. This makes me feel unsafe. This makes me feel unwanted. Okay. But that's no reason to rule out its usage. What does rule out its usage, which does make us careful, is people who've really experienced trauma, like Jenny.
Yeah.
And so I've measured it, and I rely on you as an audience to understand this is a context. I'm on stage, and I'm speaking with love. And when I say tranny, I am saying about family. I'm saying it as a hard-won, loving identity. That doesn't mean everybody has to be a tranny. That doesn't mean anybody's a tranny who doesn't want to be. But it does mean listen for context. Listen for... That's one of the problems with Twitter, is you can't really hear nuance very well. You just read the words.
Oh, I feel that it is a very nuanced medium. Seems like a great vehicle to conduct foreign policy from.
He who should not be named. Yes.
Well, no, I think that is an excellent point. I think it's also interesting to notice that that there is a kind of with visibility, like you generate your own vocabulary among a community, and that vocabulary suits a purpose that is like contextual to that community, but then as the community becomes more visible, that same jargon, those that vocabulary comes into public domain and suddenly becomes weaponized by literally people, Republicans. who now can suddenly be like, oh, are you a triggered little tranny? Are you a triggered little, you know what I mean? Like, you know how triggered, like, initially is like, it was a functional word, like, an intra-community word, and now it's like a term of derision, because it's like they heard it, and they were like, yeah, we're going to lean on this word today.
I live with borderline personality disorder.
BDP.
Yep, and post-traumatic stress disorder. My trauma that I'm post now, thank God, was my 12 years in Scientology.
Yeah.
For years I had night terrors, and I've finally gotten over that. But borderline personality I've had all my fucking life, and basically what that means is I got no control over my emotions. None, you know? Happy, you know? Angry,
yeah.
Whatever. They just run away. And DBT, dialectic behavioral therapy, combines cognitive behavioral therapy and Zen Buddhism to learn how to untrigger yourself, because basically when you live with borderline, everything can trigger you. If you just you're on the edge of everything, and we learn how to untrigger ourselves, and that's a valuable thing to learn. And what I'm writing about, I'm working on a new book,
yes,
called, and my best title yet. It's so good it doesn't have a subtitle yet. Ready? You may have heard this before. It's called Trans, just for the fun of it. And in this, I'm talking about the need to learn how to untrigger ourselves, because we live in a world in which we are colliding, as you're talking about, words in different contexts create different effects, but same exact word,
yeah,
in two different places. This is akin to the quantum physics phenomenon of what's called superposition. Superposition, I love queer science. Superposition is this: an atom can exist in two places at the exact same time.
Superposition. I think it's
super. Oh, baby.
Sorry, I interrupted.
No.
Or no, do you like that's
no.
Just
super. It's good. You're going to like it.
Okay, all right.
Superposition.
Anyway, back to quantum physics.
Which is so much more interesting. It really is. Quantum physics, an atom, right here, there's an atom, let's say. You can see it, you can measure it. You know it's that atom because it's got these qualities, and the same fucking atom is right over here, to the degree that if you drop an anvil on this one's head, this one goes, fuck, ouch! Does. Same exact atom. Words are like that. Same exact words in different contexts. This is a quantum physics phenomenon known as quantum entanglement. Subatomic particles are bouncing into each other all the time, all the fucking time, millions and gabillions of them. Wee, wee, beep, boop, beep, boop. They just bounce. Sometimes they get tangled up, boom, boom, tangled up, and they in such a way that they go flying off 10,000 light years in that direction, 20,000 light years in that direction, to the point where totally different subatomic particles, 40, 50,000 light years apart, tickle this one giggles. Language. Same word entangles two different communities. The community of trannies is now entangled with the community of people who gets triggered by that word and is tangled up with the community of people who derides that word. And we're irrevocably entangled with different communities, same fucking word. This is fascinating to me. Was that okay? Was that interesting?
That was very interesting.
Okay. All right. May I say this now?
Yeah.
This new book, I'm learning the elevator speech for this new book. Hope to finish it this year. Don't have a publisher yet. It's looking at gender through the triple Venn diagram, three circles overlapping. Postmodern theory, Eastern philosophy, and quantum mechanics. And they all overlap at slapstick.
Fiddle the hat.
There you go.
Because really, if you're going to go through all that trouble to be trans in this world, fucking have fun with it!
Yeah. Yes.
Right?
Well, it's like those are three, that Venn diagram. I guess maybe Eastern philosophy has some funny stuff. Like people smacking each other with boards and stuff.
Does a dog have Buddha nature?
Does a
dog? Waka waka! Woof woof woof.
I can't give an answer to that at the moment. The Buddha nature koan?
Yeah.
Which means
you can't.
That I win, right? I win. If I don't answer, then I win. I thought that's how Zen worked.
If you answer,
if you say, does the dog have Buddha nature? And then you go, yeah. And they smack you. And they go back! They don't say it, but that's
and
how
then,
you hear it.
And then you come
it.
Back and you say, does the dog have Buddha nature? And you say, no. And they smack you.
Yeah.
And the actual answer to that koan...
I cannot answer it at this time. Thank you.
No.
Fuck.
Not sure whether it's Japanese or Chinese word mu, which basically means aha.
Mu?
The answer to that koan is aha. Right? Think about it.
Okay. No, that's okay. Listen, I'm telling you this why I would not make
or
a very good Zen Buddhist.
Or I could have made that up. I'm not sure.
You made up mu?
I know I didn't make up mu, but I made up what mu means.
I'm very excited for this book. do you think that, back to the subject of slapstick.
Yeah.
How those three, would you like to elaborate a little bit more on how those three things become slapstick when combined? Because each of them in turn, although we can get some comic traction out of talking about the Zen stuff, because it's kooky. But quantum mechanics, a little dry, you know? And the other one, postmodern theory, not a lot of laughs to be had there. Am I crazy?
What have you been reading?
I've tried to read Derrida and stuff.
Try reading Kate Bornstein.
Oh,
I'm sorry. That was fucked up. But... I've always tried to find the humor in that shit. Again, Adam, drop an anvil on this one's head.
Adam4Adam.com. I'm sorry, I'm being very inappropriate.
It's a giggle when you find out something. Quantum theorists and quantum physicists, basically, quantum physicists live kind of by a motto. If you know what, when they're experimenting with this stuff, subatomic particles and how they behave, and if you know what you're doing, don't do it.
That's the rule of science?
It's a kind of a motto that they work by, because if you go into this thing going, oh, I know what's going to happen, you won't find out what really happens.
Yeah.
And that's how, that's a whack-a-whack-a moment right there. That's slapstick.
Yeah, okay, all right, I get it. Because slapstick is like you have a thing, it's like you have a thing on your, what is a good slapstick, lotsy thing? Like, you've got, you drop the thing and then you pick it up and then you slip and you drop. Oh, fuck, come on, come on. I wish I knew more slapstick stuff. I know the one where the hats. Do you know how in Waiting for
Basically,
Godot they do the thing with the hats?
Think of Wile E. Coyote and Roadrunner. That is slapstick.
Yeah.
Anvil falls on the fucking guy's head.
Yeah.
Right? He doesn't die. He doesn't go squish and blood, and that's the end of the cartoon.
Yeah.
He goes, and that's funny. That's funny. His eyes go red, little birds go around the head. That's funny. We all laugh at that.
Yeah.
Knowing that there's not a horrible fucking consequence. And
it is funny also that... Oh, sorry, I interrupted.
No.
It is funny also that they could probably just get along. The coyote and the roadrunner. I mean, there's like a great chain of being in which one is supposed to eat the other, but like, they don't have any beef. Except for how the Roadrunner... Never mind, they do have beef. But like, you know, the coyote is just in pursuit, hostile pursuit of the Roadrunner, always at his own expense, or their own expense. Every plan, and the more elaborate the plan, the more extravagantly it goes wrong, and comes back to hurt the coyote.
And that's the nature of experimentation in quantum physics. That's the nature of following down a loose thread in postmodern theory. That's the nature of Eastern philosophy that basically laughs at you when you think you've got a plan.
Yeah. I didn't have a plan for this conversation, and this.
I won't say a word.
I think it's going very well.
I think it is. So, are we okay?
That was a leading question. It was a leading question,
well,
but thank you.
You want to know? There were 7 people who didn't clap.
Yeah.
I saw you.
Here's the thing. Do you know that I used to be in a cult, too? I was in a commuter cult. It's not as exciting as Scientology.
Which one?
It's not really a cult. It was, but I was in a commuter cult, and they were all about this quantum physics stuff. This is my trigger. I get triggered by quantum physics because I was in a commuter cult when I was in high school, meaning that the lady would only come to town like 3 times a year, and you'd just drive out to the airport in this stupid seminar room, and she'd fucking tell you how to... You were supposed to spin your finger in weird places around your body. It was really fucked up, girl. It was like, but is that a trans thing, cults?
In as much as geekdom is a trans thing, sure.
Yeah. But geekdom is like a good, that's like a good use of transness, don't you think?
Cults can be really good in the same way that binaries can be really good. They give you a moment of certainty and safety and security, which brings up the old Hallmark greeting card of ships are safe in harbor, but that's not why ships are designed.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, it took me a second. I was like, ships, what's a ship? No, but
it's a safe harbor. A cult is a safe harbor.
Yeah.
As long as you're not being mean. Now, the cult of Scientology is very, very mean, and I would encourage you, if you haven't seen it already, on A&E, you can binge watch it. Leah Remini, The Aftermath, is a really good series.
You know what I like about her? She's tough. She's pretty, but she's tough, too.
She's a Brooklyn girl.
Yeah, she's a Brooklyn girl.
She is.
She was like a child Scientologist, right?
She was. She was raised as a Scientologist.
You were an adult Scientologist.
I was a first generation. I was there with L. Ron Hubbard while he was figuring this shit out. Yeah.
Now, do you think Would you like to know my theory about L. Ron Hubbard?
No. I bet it's the same theory as he who must not be named.
How did you know that that was my theory?
Baby, I am you.
We're very entangled. Yeah.
We are tangled up. You are me at that age, whatever age you are. I was
very
you.
Young.
But
very
you
young.
Know, I'm very old. And, but you know, like, so much more than I did. You're the same kind of wackadoodle that I was, but with a lot more wisdom than I ever had at your age. You're going to make a really good, wicked little old lady.
Yeah, this is. I like this. You mentioned this earlier. I'm looking for... I think that'll be great.
Yeah.
I love that.
It's a good thing.
I won't have all of this. You know.
Old age is a good thing, right? See? It is. It is. It is.
No, I agree.
Ooh. The perspective, the ability to contextualize, the peace of mind. You know, you finally... learn a little bit of patience?
Yeah. Do you really think that I'm going to learn patience? No. Did you used to think that you would become enlightened at some point? I used to think this. When I was in middle school, I was like, yeah, I'm the Buddha. I'm like, I'm the fucking Buddha. Somebody gave me a copy of, like, Siddhartha when I was like in middle school, and I read it and I was like, that's me. Yeah,
I was asked to recommend a book for this book project that's going to be going on in Toronto or some shit. That's the book,
Siddhartha.
I read it every couple of 3 years. Yeah,
because isn't the fucking end of that book that he's just kind of like, what the here's the other thing about being in middle school, I didn't finish that shit. But like, isn't the end of Siddhartha that he just kind of is like, oh, and he realized it was that enlightenment was just having a hot dog with your friends. Isn't
more
that kind
less.
Of where
more
it ends
less.
Up? That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Do you know that, have you ever heard of, I'm not going to go down that path. Actually, no, I will. I think you'll like this. There's a book called Sayobo There Below by Laszlo Krasznahorkai, the Hungarian master of the apocalypse.
What the fuck? Say that slowly.
So, the whole thing, it's a book called Sayobo There Below by Laszlo Krasznahorkai, who's a Hungarian writer, master of the apocalypse. But it's a nicer book for him, because a lot of his books obviously are very apocalyptic. It's kind of hard to describe, but it's like, it's every chapter is an independent unit describing an encounter with the sublime, like in the form of art, usually in a work of art. So there's a chapter about, actually the opening chapter is about the entire process of restoring a wooden Buddha at a Zen temple, and like the rituals involved, and that's like one episode, and you're like, how can you fill a whole book with it? And you realize, no, that the next chapter is going to be about like a tiny little Giotto or whatever. So, but he has a chapter about the Parthenon, about the Acropolis, where there is an old sweaty Hungarian professor who has like he's studied the classics and all this kind of stuff, and this is his one opportunity to see the Acropolis in his whole life. He goes to Greece, and this, I'm Greek and I've had experience prior to the Olympics. It was a third world country, but now it's just kind of more like a third world country, but they have a highway and an empty stadium. They have a series of empty stadiums, but like, the professor just gets there and he's sweating and it's hot and it's horrible, and his cab driver takes advantage of him, and he gets stuck at the plaza by the Parthenon, and these Greek like young people sitting around a table just like drinking and like having coffee and like talking, like, are like, what are you doing, man? And he's like, I'm going to the Acropolis. Like, he's like, I've got to go to the Acropolis. I have to see it. It's like, and they're like, why? They're like, why are you going to the Acropolis? And he's like, they're like, sit down. So he's like, okay. So he sits down with them for like an hour and has a coffee. And he's like, okay, but I really got to be going. And so he goes and says bye and goes up the hill. And like, he gets to the Acropolis. They rip him off multiple times with tickets. And they realize he doesn't have his sunglasses. And it's like really bright. And he can't see anything. And he's really hot. And it's like the sun is giving him a sunburn. Sorry, this is very involved. I'm giving away the whole chapter. But like... He just kind of sits down defeated and realizes I'll never see the Acropolis. Like I'm never gonna have this experience. I'm never gonna. And he's just totally defeated. And he walks back down the hill, and like he sees across the street the table with the Greek students, and they're still there, and they like wave to him, and he kind of meekly waves back, and has this moment of realization where he goes, this is actually the sublime. This is what it's all about. Like this is the beautiful thing that I came here to see. And he steps out into traffic to go back to the taxi, and he gets hit by a semi truck and he dies because it's Greece. Because I think Laszlo Krasznahorkai has some memories of Greek traffic. But
wait a minute.
It's not my story. But that's my favorite. I think that's my favorite. That's my favorite narrative of the sublime that I've ever read. It's like that you're trying to have this poignant experience of truth and beauty and all that kind of stuff. And it's never where you actually want it to be. It's always when you're not paying attention or when you just kind of let your guard down. And there is not really. I'm not trying to like. Envelope our discussion, but there is no like nirvana moment. There's just kind of, there's moo. You just go moo and then you die.
More or less.
I mean, right?
That would make a great t-shirt.
It's just a moo and then you die, right?
Right.
That is on the front and the right's on the back.
Moo is spelled M-U.
With a question mark, so as you walk away, they'll be like, we never knew. She never answered. How are we on time?
That is slapstick.
That is slapstick! You dirty whore. That
we all laugh. Hit by a bus. Oh, we died? Yeah. Oh, well, ho, ho.
Yeah.
Now... Was this guy writing in, what, the 50s or 60s?
No, he came out with it 3 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah. The Hungarian Master of the Apocalypse. Check him out.
It's very modernist, and nothing wrong with modernism. Modernism is the notion that everything you experience, everything you perceive, everything you can touch or see or smell or taste... or here contains absolute truth. Everything. That's modernism. There's truth in everything. We can find truth in everything. Postmodernism is the notion that what's more, everything can be seen from a gabillion different angles. And everything is anything else if you want it to be. It just puts a spin on modernism. Nothing wrong with modernism.
So it's just like friendly modernism. It's just a friendly thing. There's nothing to be afraid of from postmodernism.
Zen Buddhism was the notion that you could have this flash of lightning kind of moment and be enlightened. That is the basis of Zen.
Yeah.
You're doing something. It could be as simple as tinkering with your motorcycle, the Zen of motorcycle repair or something like that, for 20 years. And all of a sudden you go, oh, I get it. And you're enlightened. Yeah, all right. You had a nice realization. You had a moment of aha.
Yeah.
There's a lot more to nirvana than Western minds have delved into. there's a lot missing from Western philosophy. And here you have a binary, Western and Eastern, and they're very different. And Tibetan Buddhism is beginning to go, yeah, we're throwing away some of our texts because science is actually explaining it better, and it's more true than our old shit.
They're Wikipediaing it. It's like they're wiki. You know wiki? Do you know how, like, on Wikipedia, if, like, something is disproved, they take it off? It's an evolving document. That's all I mean.
Yeah, it takes a lot to throw out thousands of years of Buddhist truth.
Oh, sure, it's big wiki.
It does. It's a big wiki. It's a giant wiki, but yes. Yes.
But isn't it?
If you must reduce it to the absurd.
I must.
I know. But there is a whole lot we don't look at. The basis of, for example, Tibetan Mahayana Buddhism is you devote your life to your lives to ending suffering for all sentient beings. And you embark on a path of three countless eons until you're at a point where you're actually able to end suffering for all sentient beings, theoretically. But we don't even consider that degree of compassion in Western philosophy. That degree of love, we talk about it, we make art about it, but it doesn't pervade academia the way it pervades the Eastern version of academia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that, I think, gets to the core, and we're more or less at the end of... Okay, at the end of... I know it's terrible, right?
That, by the way, is Dan Fishback, who put Squirts together.
Dan Fishback, the ultimate Squirt!
And we are in La Mama, who has been hosting us for years. Thank you, La Mama people.
Thank you. I'm gonna add a coda, because I was gonna envelope you so hard. I was gonna give you such a good envelope structure.
Okay.
before we do final goodbyes and applauses and stuff, because Kate has party favors that she would like to hand out to people, but that, I think, gets to the core actually of the philosophy that you talk about in this book, the 101 Alternatives to Suicide, in terms of what, and I think that it's also, it cuts to the core of why live. It cuts to the core of also, like, what is right, what is wrong, and it also, on a more local level, in terms of what is identity, what is your gender, what is, like, what does it mean to be trans or to do anything, is just, like, is it a good decision? Well, like, does it keep you alive? Does it end suffering? Does it cause more suffering? Ultimately, this is a bad attempt to envelope, but the focus on ending suffering is a little bit more accommodating than, and a little bit like less binary than the kind of rigid ideas of right and wrong and clinging to laws like they're masts, do you know what I mean? In a storm of decay, of depravity. Right?
I'm a big fan of depravity. Depraved is something I gravitate toward.
Right. So ultimately,
that's why I like you, dear.
I'm a depraved.
You are a depraved
individual.
Yeah.
I'm depraved. Yeah. No. Ultimately, okay. So depraved, right? And I know we're supposed to be wrapping up and whatever. What is
Fuck
time?
That.
Time
Fuck
is,
that.
Time is just a construct.
I
hey,
know.
Did you ever hear this one? Did you ever hear this one before? Gender is just a construct.
Yes and no. Yes and no.
Oh,
because
no.
The truth of gender.
Yeah.
The truth of gender.
Yeah.
Is that there are two.
This is a koan.
There are two genders. This is the truth. Arguably. The truth of gender is that it's a construct. We can play with it. We can have fun with it. We can navigate it. We can use it to help people and help ourselves. And that's the truth. Arguably. Two kinds of truth in our conventional world. Arguable truth, definitive truth. Right? Definitive truth, there aren't very many. They're never surprising. And they're very simply stated.
Yeah.
Everyone dies.
That's,
yeah. Duh. And that's a definitive truth. Can't be argued.
Yeah.
Arguable truth. Sichuan food is the best fucking food on the planet.
Right? No arguing here.
Arguably. And when I learned this, which I learned from a 3-day teaching from the Dalai Lama at the Beacon fucking Theater.
You fucking with me?
His lecture was called Profound Wisdom and Vast Compassion, the Essence of Eloquence. Eloquence in Mahayana Buddhism, in Tibetan Buddhism, is telling a truth in such a way that it eases suffering. That is eloquence.
That's real good.
To parse that, yeah, right? To parse that, they come up with roughly two kinds of truth in the conventional world. Definitive truth and arguable truth. And I thought, okay, with all this fucking argument about gender, what is gender? Biology, no, it's a construct, no, it's a this, it's a that, I'm better gendered than you are.
That's my
What is the definitive truth that everybody, no matter how grudgingly, would have to agree with?
Yeah.
And I found it. I found the definitive truth of gender.
Would you reveal it to the class?
Book will be out in about a year.
Motherfucker!
Oh! Motherfucker! Everybody please give it up for Kate Bornstein! Dan Fishback, Nikki and Squirts, LaMama.
No. I can reveal the definitive truth of gender.
Oh, mother!
It's easy. It's not surprising, and it's simply stated. And I hope you use this in these hard times that are coming, especially over gender and sexuality, to ease tensions of infighting in gender and sexuality communities. The definitive truth of gender can be stated in two ways, the simple way and the academic way. The simple way is gender is relative. The fact that people have so many definitions of it proves that. The academic way of stating it is gender is relative to context and point of view. So we can acknowledge people's truth of gender and go, okay, I guess that eases your suffering to adhere to that truth. The enforcement of an arguable truth is violence. And so what we cannot afford to do in our multi-gendered, multi-sexualityed world that we've developed over the last couple of decades, we cannot afford to enforce our truth of gender on anyone else, including people who understand that there is a binary. There are men and there are women. Okay, that works. It does. It's worked for eons. So it's true, arguably. We let people have that. We let people go, I'm non-binary. Okay, if that works for you and eases your suffering, good. That's what works for me, but I don't want to enforce it on anyone else. And that's what I kind of did in the first edition of Gender Outlaw. I created my own fucking binary without knowing it, and I'm so glad I had a chance to go back and redo it. In the discovery that I'm not man, not woman, I created the binary of non-binary, these languages, wasn't using this language, non-binary good, binary bad. Oh, those people who believe they're men and women, ho, ho, ho. And I snubbed a lot of fucking people. And I'm so glad I had a chance to, with the knowledge of arguable truth, go back and revise that and go, yeah. Of course, you're a man. Great. That's what you are. Mazel tov. You know?
That's so lovely. That's very lovely.
Okay.
I'm literally I'm struggling to express the loveliness. And it sounds like I'm cheapening it. That's the struggle.
It will be a struggle all your life because you are a cheap bitch.
I want you to hand out party favors.
Okay.
Cheap bitch wants you to hand out party favors to our wonderful crowd.
Okay. In these hard times, there's no doubt going to be moments of deep despair. I'm so sorry. I wish, as an elder, I was leaving a better world. It's going to get really fucking rocky, dangerous. People are going to die. The world has been through this. This is the nature of a binary. A binary swings this way, over decades. Okay, we can weather this. To weather it in your heart and to make your life worthwhile, I'm giving you permission to do whatever the fuck you want to do in order to make your life more worth living. Anything. That's the basis of this book. You do anything that makes your life worthwhile. Unethical, immoral, self-destructive, anything.
Yeah, especially.
Right? Especially. There's only one rule, don't be mean. Mean is what got us into this mess of he who shall not be named. And if we start returning mean for mean, I swear it's not going to work. I swear it's not going to work. But how can we make life delightful for ourselves? We do whatever the fuck we want to do as long as we're not being mean. Now, for some people, that could mean, like, great sex, wonderful, fun gender, all of which will get you sent to hell. It will. And that's totally the truth.
Totally.
Arguably. That's the truth. What we do for fun will get us sent to hell. That's the nature of a binary world we live in. But I've got that covered, just in case they're right. Everybody here is going to get a get-out-of-hell-free card.
There you go.
It comes with strings attached. Here's how it works. You do, my children, whatever, and my brothers and sisters, you do whatever you need or want to do to make your life a little bit better. Anything. Because it'll be hard times, but you'll always be able to make it a little bit better, a little bit more worth living. Anything you want, just don't be mean. And if you get sent to hell for doing something that wasn't mean, hang on to the card, give it to Satan. I will do your time for you. Masochist. Everybody wins.
Everybody wins.
And with that, please keep it going for Kate Bornstein. Motherfucking class act. The ultimate squirt. Careful, baby. Well, I think that's it. Do we have a... This is very trans to end with one of the headliners out in the crowd. Okay, great. That's it. We're done, right? I'm going to get off mic now. Yeah. We're all done. We're all done. Okay.